I'm very happy to be here to give this presentation, because here we'll present an idea, a vision that we've developed over the last few months together with the OpenAIRE project on how an augmented OpenAIRE service could be suitable for EGI, for an infrastructure, to solve the problem of opening up the scientific outcome of the infrastructure and tracking all the results of the activities. In this presentation, we'll touch three main points. And the first one, first I want to give a short introduction of what is EGI, so that you can understand the problem that we're addressing here, why we feel there are some barriers at the moment on tracking and sharing the scientific output. And also, I will at the end, I will show what is our idea in terms of collaboration with OpenAIRE to solve the problem of tracking the scientific output of the research that has been done in EGI. So let's start first from the user viewpoint. Before telling what is EGI, I want to tell you what users of the EGI infrastructure can do. EGI, okay, is about digital research. It's about enabling, providing distributed computing capabilities to large virtual collaborations, and it offers a platform for different disciplines to manage digital data that comes from the experiments or from simulations, and then to process them and to derive scientific results that then get into some publication. Here we have three examples, and on the left-hand side you can see high energy physics, which at the moment is our main customer. Basically, all the experiments have been done at CERN in Geneva. All the data have been generated with the collider they used to make experiments in energy physics are shared across 8,000 researchers worldwide. And in order to, they generate around 15 petabytes of data every year. They need to process this data. And for instance, in the last year, they consumed a kind of 1 billion of CPU hours. In the middle, you can see another use case, which is about diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease. Using NMR technologies today, and the hospitals are generating lots of images, which are about disease, brain disease. And what researchers want to do is to access all the different images that are available and to analyze them and to process in order to detect early stage and of the disease and possible to intervene in advance. On the right-hand side, you can see another example in the life science community where basically the structural biologists, they use EGI to run the workflow on analyzing moleculars and to derive, for instance, new medicine or antibiotics. If you want to know more on this, you can go and see on the link which is on the bottom. So basically, we see what researchers can do with EGI. We saw some example. Now let's see who is providing EGI, who is making this infrastructure. EGI is a federation, it's a European federation of resources that are funded at the each national country. And that are through the technology we provide the framework basically to federate all of them, so to enable researchers to use them all together. So to break the highlands of individual research centers to make them a virtual computing capabilities for them. At the moment, we have more than 35 countries, and each country is establishing a national coordinating body which is responsible for the national computing resources in the country. And there is a European coordinating body, which is called EGI.eu, which is the foundation for which I work, and it's located in Amsterdam. We are around 26 people at the moment who perform the coordination of this federation. I will not go very much in details on the technical part. I will just give you an idea of what EGI provides. So basically, on the ground, we have the infrastructure, which are the IT assets from the research-funded data centers that are funded by individual countries. And what we provide basically is a technology to make all these individual resources work as a unique federation. On top of this technology, we provide a number of services. For instance, authentication, so that if a user using a single credential can access resources all over the countries without applying for different authentication IDs. Also, we provide support services, and also we enable user communities to deploy their own services on this infrastructure. Above this stack of services, there are the users who can run their own digital research, and everything is coordinated by EGI.eu. Looking a bit in perspective, what we are doing at the moment is that as technology evolves and the concept of grid was invented during the 90s, was implemented in Europe in the last decade, but now things changed. Now virtualization is a commodity. Everybody, most of you on a day-to-day basis now, they hear about cloud computing. What we are doing now, we have a roadmap also to adopt, to offer cloud-like services in the EGI infrastructure. And the idea is to basically, what we did 15 years ago for the grid, say we federated individual data centers, we want to do the same with the cloud. So we want to inject cloud technologies in the data centers and make a cloud federation, like if you could use Amazon, Google, and other cloud providers all together. Because our challenge is to work with many independent autonomous providers. Why we want to do this? Because the virtualization enables, provides more flexibility for the users. At the moment, there are user communities who are not interested in EGI because the kind of services that have been developed for the physicists, for the biologists, are not good for the humanities, for instance. They have their own services, they would have to deploy in a flexible way the infrastructure. Through the virtualization, we can enable this. We can enable, we can give the key, in a way, to the virtual infrastructure, to the users, and they can deploy their own services. Looking a bit at the history, EGI, the idea of this European grid started in 2001 with a pilot project, like now we can have the example of OpenAIRE, because from pilot to service. Then we have the second phase from 2004 to 2010, where from prototype we provided a production service. And now from a project-based organization, we are, through the EGI Inspire project, we are moving to a network of permanent organizations in order to provide a sustainable service for the future. What is interesting to see also in the from this diagram, if you think about OpenAIRE, about scientific impact, many projects built, contribute to the building of the current EGI. But for today, I would like to know how many scientific publications are linked to EGI. We don't know, because usually this kind of tracking is banned by other funding program or by project. And there are many side projects who contributed to EGI, but also national fundings who are not, at the moment, you cannot see here. So basically, it's important to see that there are research infrastructures who have a long-term life. They may even change name on the along their life, like EGI was called EDG before, then EGE, now is EGI. And also, there are different streams of fundings. Each stream of fundings, each funding agency would like to know what is the scientific impact of this money I invested in infrastructure. Just a few data now to the current project. EGI Inspire is an FP7 project from 2010 to 2014, which is helping us to transition to a network of permanent organizations. There is only 25 million of contribution from the Commission, but the whole effort from the member states is 330 million, because also the infrastructure, the servers, computers, storage, they are not paid by the European Commission, but they are paid by the member states. And we have, at the moment, 50 partners in this project. In this slide, I would like to tell you a bit how we see EGI contributing to the Europe 2020 strategy. There are two main flagships that we see where EGI has an impact, where we are having a contribution. One is the Digital Agenda for Europe, but the other one is the Innovation Union. In the digital agenda for Europe, we see EGI first as a supporting a single digital market for computing resources, because through the enabling this federation, basically we offer research communities, which are spread in Europe, but also outside, a single way, a uniform way to access them. They don't need to build their own, say, adapters or try to combine resources, because we provide already this abstraction. And also, it's a way to stimulate competitiveness and interoperability, because EGI works on open standards. So all the technology we develop, we mandate the adoption of open standards. And this, the effect of having open standards means that new actors can enter with their own solutions if they are more good in implementing the software component. Improve efficient spendings, because EGI, if we see, is a framework for implementing the distributed computing infrastructure for research, who pull together funding from member states, from the European Commission, in a all unique initiative. So it avoids highlands and duplication of spendings. And also it addresses grand challenges, because given that we pool all the resources together, we offer scientists a more capable and higher capacity infrastructure for their digital research. In terms of innovation union, we see EGI also as a tool to implement the digital European research area, promotes skill development, because in the last decade, generation of IT experts have been trained on distributed technologies, but also researchers. And also EGI has connections. So we have many agreements with partners outside Europe. So we cover almost all the globe about connecting the European computing infrastructure to infrastructure like US, Latin America, or Asia, for instance. Given this first part on EGI, now we are trying to approaching the context which is more connected to this conference, which is about how do we track the scientific input of all this infrastructure. Here we have some number about EGI. So at the moment there are 351 different research data centers who provide computing capabilities, who are federated through the NGIs. We have 470,000 logical CPUs, 143 petabytes of disk, and 138 petabytes of tape. And one thing we need to consider here in order to understand what is the challenge for EGI in terms of tracking the scientific output is that this is a federation, so each center retains its own autonomy. So there is no single control, there is no central control for which we can say to this certain discipline today we provide, we allocate this computing power or this amount of storage. So each resource center retains the negotiation capability with the research community. So say if there is an Italian group in structural biology wanting certain amount of computing capabilities of storage to do their digital research, they go to the National Grid Initiative, they will make the agreement with them. If they have a connection with another group in Netherlands or in Spain, the other researcher will do the same on the national country, and through EGI they can use all these resources together. So this kind of autonomy, in a way, it's a barrier for us to understand who is accessing what on the infrastructure and what kind of research they are doing. It's difficult to make, to have a single enforcement point to say to researchers, okay, if you use the infrastructure now, I give you only the services you provide to me at the end of the scientific publication. And if this is done, it's at the national level, so it's difficult to pull everything together. At the moment, we have more than 20,000 users, which are spread in 233 different groups. So there are 233 different virtual, what we call virtual organizations, which are a grouping of researchers spread in Europe outside, and they work together toward the same goal on the same topic. So basically today with EGI, researchers can easily share ICT infrastructure, data, applications, and training material, but still we need to improve the tracking of the scientific output. What is the current approach? How do we track? Because anyway, we have also been funded by European projects. We need to report on the commission about what are the publications that have been possible thanks to EGI. At the moment, basically, we ask to our partners, the NGIs, so the National Consortium, to provide periodically the publications that the national researchers produce using the infrastructure. Since these organizations are new, they don't have major processes in place, so at the end we have partial results. So for us it's difficult to collect all that has been published thanks to EGI. What would be the ideal for us? Would be to, our need is that since we want to be a sustainable infrastructure for the long term, we need to establish policies and processes and tools that help us to track all the scientific output that is possible thanks to EGI, and also to open up between the researchers. And in order to tackle this problem, in June, we created a dedicated task force to analyze the problem and see how we could solve this. And I was leading this task force, and we have a recommendation document that you can see linked there. And because of this task force, now I'm here today. And I will show you briefly what we did in this. Basically, we try to understand why it's difficult today to track all this scientific output from EGI. So first, it came out there is a lack of awareness. So researchers may get access to EGI. They may give in a digital certificate from their when they enter virtual group. And they may use the EGI through a web portal that has been developed for that specific community. So basically, EGI is behind that portal. And they may not be aware they're using EGI. This is one problem. So one problem is that if they don't know, they will not be able to cite us. Second problem is that even though if they know, they may not appreciate the importance of citing EGI. They get the infrastructure usually for free, let's say, and they may not understand the importance of citing EGI as an enabling tool for them to achieve the results, and then to report us back and for us to demonstrate the value of the infrastructure. And the third part is that there is a lack of efficient or effective services for us to track, even though we get to know to researchers. They cite us, it's difficult to track all the publication from 21,000 researchers for which we don't have a day-to-day contact because they work in autonomy in the Federation. We identified these three main barriers, and then also we defined some action how we can solve this. And in terms of the awareness, we are planning to create a kind of site EGI campaign. We are in EGI, we are defining a championing program to promote EGI toward the researchers. What we'd like to do also to make a kind of campaign and then ask all the developers of user interfaces for what we call science gateways, basically is the web interface that the researcher use to access the infrastructure, to make it visible in this web interface, to link to this web page, and then they will click and then maybe understand what is behind the web interface they are using. Second one is to stimulate engagement. How we can do this? First, they need to share the importance of EGI. So we need to make them aware of the importance of the value added of EGI. And then second, so we need a bit of stick and carrot technique here. And each user, when they get access to the infrastructure, they need to accept an acceptable use policy. There are a number of rules they need to comply with. What we want to do is to add one rule that is, if you make a publication that relies on work done on EGI services, then you have to cite EGI in the publication. And the carrot here would be we run two main conferences every year where we attract around 500 people. The idea is to make prize or review on our publications all the authors. Maybe we can we need to identify how we can select authors of publications that made cited EGI. So these are some ideas on how we can stimulate engagement. And this would move, if we succeed in one and two, we will succeed in having our name in the publication. Then third is how do we collect all the all these publications. We need to establish appropriate services. We want to minimize human intervention because researchers already deposit usually the publication on the under university. They don't want to be bothered to deposit twice. So it should be easy to use. And also should be, this service should be infrastructure specific. That means that it needs to collect all the publications, all the extra metadata that you want, we feel useful for an infrastructure. Given these three actions that we identified, now we'll focus on the third one because it's the one that will connect to OpenAIRE. We went to more in the analysis phase on what do we want from this service. So we want a service to be able to enable researchers to supply link or claim their publication. We don't, in general, we're not interested in the paper. We just want to know that the paper exists and that it was possible thanks to EGI. So it should be very minimal effort. The researchers should, if the publication doesn't cite EGI, so it's not possible to automatically discover it, researchers should be able to deposit it just putting the DOI, the digital object identifier. Eventually, we want to offer also the possibility to deposit the file, but as I said, it's not a priority for us because there is already a main repository somewhere for which we can pull the publications if we need. And then, especially, this is a very important feature, we would like to, as we want to reduce human intervention, once researchers cite the publication, we want tools that enables us to automatically discover these publications. And we want also some extra information. We want to know that the publication is connected, was possible thanks to EGI. We want to know also what is the virtual organization, the group, the research groups that to which this publication is linked, not just the author, and also the EGI scientific discipline. We have our own categorization. We would like also to support federated authentication. We don't want users to have a research having an extra authentication ID and password. They already have an ID they use to access EGI. We would like them to use the same. So it's what is nowadays called federated authentication. Once a publication is mentioned, claimed in this service, we would like to receive a notification and to verify from EGI's view perspective. And also we would like to have a number of statistics that can help us to understand the publications by scientific disciplines, by group, who is performing well in terms of research outcome and so on. So then when we had this list, then we started to think about how to implement this service. Should we have our own repository? And or should we rely on something external? We were aware of the OpenAIRE initiative, so I contacted the project coordinators, and we had some dialogue on this, and understood was, I had to say, a high level overview of OpenAIRE, was not sure it was a suitable solution for us, and I thought, yeah, this is very, provides already lots of what we want to do, but it's not yet complete. So the idea is to, why don't we, instead of reinventing the wheel, why we don't work together to extend OpenAIRE and then we can use it as a service. So without installing any software on us, we don't want to care, say, about managing an extra service because this is not our core business. So the idea is that we came out with this idea, why we don't improve this analysis and understand what is missing in OpenAIRE to satisfy our needs. And then OpenAIRE would be our, the what EGI proposes as a repository where we track all the scientific output of EGI. Coming back to the list, basically, as we can see, half of these requirements are met already, half needs some change, some development in OpenAIRE, but given the initial estimate, it's very easy to implement. This can be done in the order of months of work, so early next year we can have already a prototype. So what is the idea? The idea is that an EGI user, okay, first that once EGI researchers cite EGI in the publication, in their own publications, this will appear automatically. Second is that if they have a publication for which there is no explicit citation of EGI, we would like them to go to, let's say, a customized OpenAIRE portal, which maybe they just go to the EGI website. We can brand an OpenAIRE EGI portal. Once they log in, it's already known that they are part of EGI, so they don't need to express that they are part of EGI. We know already the virtual organization for which they are part, so maybe they just need to say, okay, I did this publication. They will put the DOI, they will just click, I did this through this virtual organization, and the virtual organization is already to link to the discipline, so it should be very minimal effort. The idea is to give them this service, this custom service that they can find on the EGI website, but on the back usually is, would be OpenAIRE, basically. What are the benefits over this? If we achieve this, basically we will have a single access point for all the scientific publications for EGI, and this will be, since then the data will go into an OpenAIRE, will be a single access point for all Europe, basically. This will accelerate discovery of the publications across the EGI users, access and reuse. It will minimize the burden of your researchers because through OpenAIRE we can, and these modifications, we can keep this to the minimum. And it will help us to demonstrate the impact, scientific impact of the infrastructure and also of the virtual research collaborations. And also we can have a number of very nice statistics that we can use to either to plan for the review or the evolution of the services, also to demonstrate to the funding agencies what we were able to do or what researchers were able to do thanks to EGI. And this idea, I mean, EGI, we expect to be not the only one with this problem. If you know the S3 project, there will also a project that will last for decades. They will have the same problem. So once OpenAIRE does this pilot with us, then they can offer this kind of service for others. And this would be, in a way, a win-win situation, because we get our problem solved through OpenAIRE, and OpenAIRE can open up and this solution to more infrastructures. So concluding, EGI is an infrastructure that pulls together ICT resources for research, enable digital research in Europe, and supports virtual research collaborations. I explained what are the current barriers for us to track the scientific output of EGI. And also, I explained this vision that we've developed over the last months about how an augmented OpenAIRE can remove these barriers from us and also can be an enabler for us to open up the scientific output of EGI and enable demonstrating us the impact, but also enable researchers to use and reuse the scientific output. Thank you very much. If you have any questions.